The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome to episode 70 of the Big Scottish Football Podcast. I'm Stephen Mill and he's Ewen Cameron. How are you doing?
Good morning, Stephen. Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are listening around the world. Yes, it's lovely to be here. Had a nice weekend. Can I talk about my weekend or do you want to go somewhere else first?
No, you can talk about your weekend as long as you keep it very brief.
A couple of recommendations for you. There was a restaurant that I went to on Saturday. What was the name of it?
I've got no idea.
I told you when I came in.
Oh, The Botanist.
That, I was in that place.
It's the Botanist,
yeah. Yeah, it was the first time I'd been to The Botanist and I'd ordered a club sandwich, which was lovely. But I made a mistake because my wife got some hanging chicken.
Yeah, they put it on a sort of like hanging skewer type thing. Yeah. I've been before.
So, I'm not going to show you a picture. So,
You don't need to show us a picture.
Think of bits of chicken that have been skewered.
And then it's hanging. I've explained it quite adequately.
And in between the bits of chicken that are skewered are like peppers and onions and stuff.
Aye.
And then underneath the hanging chicken, there is a bowl of chips. And what you do is you get the sauce that comes with the chicken and you pour it into a little saucer type thing at the top of the hanging chicken, and then it drips down the chicken, the sauce, all the way down the skewer, and then the remaining sauce falls into your bowl of chips. I mean, thoroughly enjoyed it. I had two bits of my wife's chicken. It was lovely. Club sandwich was great. So yeah, The Botanist, recommend that restaurant. And I also want to recommend another movie because I do like to recommend my movie. Go and get me my theme tune, please, mate, for movies. Thank you. It's not a long review, just a quick one. I love my horror movies. So I watched the sequel to The Nun. The Nun 2 is a recommendation for me this week. So if you want to watch a horror movie, The Nun 2, it's about a demon nun
yeah.
who is going round and killing priests in 1956 and then ends up at an all-girls boarding school. And the demon is inside the janitor who is at the boarding school helping with the children, and he doesn't know the demon's living inside him. And
so it's more the Janny as opposed to
No, the nun's there, but the nun is using...
But the Janny 2 doesn't have the same ring to it as...
No. Oh, I wouldn't watch a Janny 2.
No.
But the Nun 2 is very good. That's another recommendation. So go to The Botanist, have some hanging chicken, and then go home and watch The Nun 2. That's your plans for this weekend.
At your school, did your Janny live in a wee house?
Next to the school.
Next to the school.
Aye. And yeah. He had all the balls and the frisbees.
Why?
Because he wouldn't give us them back.
You'd have a horrible Janny then.
We had a horrible Janny. Oh, kept all the balls. Janny. We also had a Janny that would stick a knife or scissors through the ball.
Really?
If we kicked onto the roof. Or sometimes you'd accidentally hit a window and break the window.
Yeah, that happened.
That does happen. And then he would actually stab the ball.
That's a horrible Janny. Yeah, I mean, that sounds like another film. That's the Janny 2 that we've just described there. So thank you very much for that. Lots of correspondence with regards to your movie recommendations. Big Time Burger says, Ewan's movie recommendations are like the old drunk boy from the pub getting a taxi home. Enjoy your night, mate. Bung Holio, any chance you could do the quiz at the start of the show just so Ewan can leave before we need to listen to his pish? Dale McKinnon says, for Stephen, to compare it to other bad decisions is complete nonsense. This is obviously the Rangers offside. We are now about three weeks on from this, yeah. And we're still talking about it. And no other game has there been offside. Has there been 20 minutes? Absolutely fair play, Rangers.
Thanks, Derek.
It was Dale, but you know, I don't care.
I think Dale follows me on Twitter. He's a nice guy.
I don't care. Christopher Todd's making a similar point as well. And again, I'd just like to say, for the record, I don't care. So I said what I said, and I can't be bothered.
He's a nice guy as well. I like him.
I'm sure Christopher and Dale are lovely guys. And just to clarify, they're perfectly entitled to their opinion. And thank you very much for getting in touch. We all need to move on with your lives, and I suggest that you probably need to move on with your lives as well.
However, that's a bit harsh.
Something funny did happen during the week, though, and it was an old clip from this podcast that went viral again. Now, Ewan,
half a million people have listened to this clip. How do people find these things?
Because it was probably about this time last year,
that
you had a big, massive rant about Celtic fans because they were unhappy with some refereeing decisions. I think it was the Conor Goldson handball, I think that's what sort of sparked off. You went on a big, massive rant about how Celtic fans are buying into conspiracy theories and they should get a life and all the rest
of it. And the referees aren't out to get them.
So if you'd just like to recreate that rant for Rangers fans, fans, please. The camera's up there. No, just no, fair's fair. Fair's fair.
Balance it out.
Well, no, if you're going to say that about Celtic fans, I mean, surely, I mean, let's be honest. There's been a lot of conspiracy theories going around.
Yeah, okay, right. I made my point last week on this. I still believe it. Rangers, up until they said that Willie Collum shouldn't referee their matches, had a point.
But you said it wasn't a penalty.
But I don't think it was a penalty. But what I'm saying is, how they came to that decision, I agree with what Rangers were doing in regards to transparency,
right,
and also to tell us about the process. Nothing wrong with that. And I think most Scottish football fans would agree with that. The point where they lost
got
me,
that, though. They had a meeting with the SFA.
But the point that they lost me, as I said last week, and we're not going to go over old ground, is when they said to Willie Collum, right, I don't want them refereeing my games anymore.
So there's the camera there. The camera there. No. You can see the hypocrisy in this.
You're calling me a hypocrite.
Yeah, because
you're calling me a hypocrite.
This time last year, you sat and you ranted, as everybody saw on Twitter this week. You ranted and ranted about Celtic fans being paranoid.
This is not the same.
Conspiracy theories. No, well,
it's not the same.
Explain how it's not the same.
It's not the same, Stephen.
Explain how it's not the same.
Because there was a belief, and there has been a belief for a long time with some Celtic fans, that the referees were out to get them, that the referees were all in it for Rangers, etc., etc., etc.
So Rangers fans have been saying the exact same things about Willie Collum over the last 3 weeks?
Oh, no, they have.
Right, okay, so there's the camera there. On you go.
Well, listen, as I've said about Celtic fans, I'm going to say to the Rangers fans as well, and I'm going to say to all of Scottish football and all football fans, there is no conspiracy. I think the referees do as good a job as they possibly can under the circumstances. I don't think they're biased towards one team or the other. I've always believed that. I'm not one of these conspiracy theorists. So to Rangers fans, cut out the nonsense. Your club had a point, and then they lost me when they asked for Willie Collum not to referee your games anymore. So, yes, to Rangers fans, there is no conspiracy, there is no SFA conspiracy, and there's nobody out to get you. That's it. It's the same.
Well done. That's all you needed to do.
But it's true, though.
That's all you needed to do.
But I'll say that about every Scottish football fan.
That's absolutely fair. And like, I totally agree. You've been fairly consistent on that.
Thank you.
There you are. Okay.
You little shit.
Right. Lots of chat about league reconstruction last week as well, because you can tell it's the winter break. Gordon says, after listening to today's pod, Scottish football needs this league format, an 18-team league, 4 Old Firm games, a better chance of an upset, more opportunities to bring in youth players. I don't know how you get 4.
No, we don't get 4.
Celtic Rangers games from an 18-team league unless they're playing about 64 games a year. So I don't know how that quite works. Maybe you can come back and show you're working on that, Gordon. We're open to theories as well. I did see quite a few other nice suggestions in terms of like 16-team leagues, 18-team leagues that split and had playoffs and stuff like that as well. I think all of these things should be discussed. I think that we're probably reaching the stage over the next 5 to 10 years. And you know, there's somebody else, I can't remember who it was here, Soul Destroyer 199. I did prefix this by saying I don't know exactly how Rangers and Celtic fans feel about playing each other 4 times a season.
We'll put a poll up on the Twitter page.
Yeah,
let's do that.
Soul Destroyer says, I hate playing the other Glasgow team so much per season. I actually hate the split as well. Top league should be either 16 or 18, play each other once home and away, with 2 or 3 up and down. Premiership 18 teams, 18 teams championship, 18 teams conference. Everyone else that doesn't make it in the top flight, tough luck. Stop blaming Rangers and Celtic. We don't want the status quo either. I would take issue with that. I think Celtic and Rangers very much want the status quo.
I think the clubs do. I'm not sure the fans do.
I think we can separate the clubs and the fans. There'll be lots of fans like Soul Destroyer.
Correct.
Who doesn't want the status quo. I can absolutely 100% guarantee that Celtic and Rangers want the status quo because it suits them down to the ground.
So
now, also, he goes on to make a point, sorry, Ewen,
go on,
that there's other teams who like having their 2 or 3 games against Celtic and Rangers every year, of course, and they're to blame as well.
Yeah.
They need to get themselves to fuck.
Yes.
So, like, absolutely. So there's a lot of things.
You balanced it up there because the other clubs are just as much to blame as Celtic and Rangers.
And I made this point last week. Neil Doncaster gets a lot of slagging, quite rightly in some cases, but also he is only acting on the club's instructions. A, if the clubs wanted rid of Neil Doncaster, they could do that today.
Yes, they could.
They could literally do that today.
Mm-hmm.
They could have a vote and vote him out. Secondly, if they wanted any changes to the league, to the way the league's set up, how many people get promoted, the competition, the format, whatever it is, they could do that today.
Yes.
But they don't want to because a combination of Celtic and Rangers are obviously quite happy because they clean up and win everything. Now, I'm not saying that
wouldn't happen,
but I think it would probably give other teams, depending on how you change that, a wee bit more of a chance. Also, the other teams, as Soul Destroyer rightly points out, is they are so desperate to get their two or three home games against Celtic or Rangers and they can't see the wood for the trees.
Yeah. All good points. My brother-in-law, and I've said this before, he's married to my sister and he's a season ticket holder at Parkhead and he goes to every single home game, goes to a few away games as well, and he goes with his dad and he goes with his brother and he's bored of playing the same teams week in and week out four times a season, etc.
Just interesting.
Rangers fans that I know, sick and tired of playing each other four times a season and possibly five or six of us in the cup and that. So I think what you've got is that the vast majority of football fans out there would love to see a reconstruction of the leagues and not to be playing each other four times a season or more if you're meeting in the cups. So I think this is a football club issue and not a fan issue.
100%. Also, interesting to see this week as well that Rangers have, in exchange for two pay-per-view games,
I saw that,
allowed Sky to have another game at Ibrox. So there'll be five games at Ibrox this season, which is great. Yeah. There needs to be flexibility and stuff like this. And we've said this before. The reason that we do have Livingston versus Motherwell later on this season on the telly, and by the way, I've got absolutely no problem with that game being shown. But
it's about quotas.
It's all about how many times they are going to show matches at each home ground. And yes, they're limited to four. Again, the reason that is because that's what the clubs wanted.
Correct.
Because they wanted to protect their home attendances. Now, I can kind of get that.
And the TV money that comes with it.
Yes. So I can kind of understand that. But there needs to be a wee bit more flexibility. So that deal that the Rangers did with the SPFL during the week, I think is quite a good thing. So we'll see what happens going forward. Elsewhere, Ewen has a good point about high-quality sportsmen loving to win and hating to lose. That's why I would be surprised if Lauren Shankland doesn't do everything he can to get a move away from Hearts this window.
Well, what's the date now? The date is the 15th of January, yes. And there is no chat about Shankland leaving.
There's more chat about his contract, to be honest.
Correct. It's all gone very quiet. Rangers have gone quiet. Celtic have gone quiet. Sunderland, Norwich. It's all very quiet. I said it last week and I'm saying it again. Lauren Shankland will not be going to Rangers. He will not be going to Celtic. He's staying in Edinburgh. He's going to be at Tynecastle on the 1st of February. The sooner you realise that, the better you're going to feel. Go and look elsewhere for a striker because he ain't coming to your team.
Derek says, surely the hardest question in Scottish football is, what does Ewan Cameron's wife do as a job? We never got to the bottom of that last week. Also, Derek says he's got a solution for the conspiracy theories about the quiz, because you're full of them.
Yeah.
Questions A and B get pulled in a sealed envelope on the desk. You flip a coin, the winner picks whatever envelope they want to read them, and then we read the questions to each other.
Nah.
Nah.
I don't want that responsibility because I just need to concentrate on the quiz enough to worry about reading questions to you.
Stratus says, can we have a special Ewan quiz where he gets five Hearts questions and if he doesn't get all five, he has to end the show by himself with a smile? I'd quite enjoy that. Porgy Boy says, great show as usual, guys. Thank you very much. Ewan, if I remember correctly, you were the one who agreed to be referred to as Jambo Bear.
I didn't agree to that.
Your true colours are starting to shine through as a Rangers fan. And finally, the quiz, moaning as per about Stephen's easy questions. He's obviously more clued up than you, as he generally knows the answers to most of your questions that you get wrong as well. So thank you very much, Porgy Boy. Mark Doyle says, Ewan definitely getting stitched up like a kipper with the quizless questions.
Correct.
Which were way harder. Unless you watch football in lower leagues, which most of us don't know how you're supposed to know where Forfar play. But that's general knowledge, as far as I'm concerned. General knowledge. It was funny the first time winding up, but now it's just cruel. I mean,
it's cruel. See this Jambo Bear nonsense. Now, I know for those of you
have said numerous occasions,
don't call me Jambo
Bear.
Don't
call Ewan Cameron Jambo Bear. Just don't do it.
Now,
if you think it's big and it's clever, it's not. Don't call him Jambo Bear. He hates it.
Okay, I'm going to show you a picture from 24 years ago. Now, I know if you're listening to the podcast,
If you're listening on Spotify, but jump onto YouTube because you can see us on YouTube.
There's a picture. I'm holding it up. I'll just hold it to get the right light, and you can see that I'm holding my firstborn, who's now 24, and I'm wearing the Hearts home.
We
strip.
Don't know that that is you. To be fair,
no, that is
like,
me.
Your face is covered.
Well,
there.
I'll show you another picture then.
Right, your face is covered there,
and there's me wearing the Hearts away strip.
Yeah.
There, can you go back to that, please? There you go. There I am, wearing the Hearts Away shirt. That was 25 years ago.
I don't know if the cameras quite picked up that picture as well.
But don't say anything.
You have one of those, what is known in the industry as a soul patch. Just a wee... Somebody slagged off my beard last week.
They did slag your beard off. They said it looked like it had been painted on.
It had been sprayed on. But the thing is, this is... like I've had a shave since last week. That's just how my facial hair grows. However, that picture, if you can put it... Look
there
at that.
There you go. So there is a little bit at the bottom.
Look at that!
What's that bit called there under your chin? That wee kind of like hairy bit?
You've decided to leave.
I've decided to leave that there, yeah.
I mean,
are you wearing a backwards baseball cap in that picture as well?
Yes, I am.
Jesus. That was the early 90s.
25 years ago.
Chain
and I had the Hearts Home and Away strip that I got sent out to me when I was living in the Middle East, right? So this Jambo Bear pish, right?
No,
let's end it now.
That's the Jambo part of the Jambo Bear.
Shut up.
That's how they merge.
Okay, let's talk about the pishy leagues.
No, we're going to do a chart rundown first.
Oh, chart rundown. Get the music, mate.
Yeah, we need a countdown. Please, producer John, if we have the countdown music. There we go. Anything you like. Right, count me in.
Yeah. Paul Hardcastle, top of the pop scene tune. Into the 80s, into the 90s. Chart countdown of who's listening where. You ready? Here we go. The chart begins now.
Okay, in the UK, we're at number 46. Canada up to number 60. Australia breaking into the top 50 as well. New Zealand 71. Belgium creeping into the top 100 at 97. Turkey 31st in the Turkish charts this week.
Get in.
Which I think is quite good. 47th in the UAE. And of course, the Cayman Islands coming through for us again. We are the 12th biggest podcast in the Cayman Islands.
John, do me a favour, go and do a Google search on the Cayman Islands. Let me tell us what the population is of that island, please.
Right, you are.
Yeah, I mean,
you're getting any more in the charts?
Can we? No, that's it. Can we do a live show from the Cayman Islands?
We should phone somebody in the Cayman Islands next week.
That's a good shout. I will ask the bosses if we can do that. I think it's quite an expensive place to go to. Cayman
so
Islands.
There's actually a place in the Cayman Islands called East End.
Oh, we're not going there.
We can do it live from East End.
68,136 people in the last census, and that was in 2021.
Thank you, my friend.
So about 60,000. Right,
so what's the time difference between us and the Cayman Islands? So here it's 11:30 in the morning. What would it be there?
It's just to the other side of Jamaica. It's sort of in between...
6:27 a.m. at the moment.
Right, so I think we should do a show from the Cayman Islands. I think that'd be great.
Very popular.
Do they have an airline?
Cayman Air.
Should go with Cayman Air.
Yeah, I don't know. But
do a show around the pool?
I thought that'd be great.
I like that.
Do a competition where listeners of the podcast get a chance to come with us.
Have they got any football teams, John?
Let's have a look.
If there's a league, Cayman Islands Football League.
Cayman Islands.
They must have a league, eh?
You think so?
They must have an international team as well, eh?
Yeah, they will do. Of course they will. Right, I've got the Cayman Islands Premier League in front of me now.
Wow.
Who's at the top of the league?
I don't know. Scholars International have won the last three titles.
Wow. Well, they're good, then.
Solid team.
Yeah.
They're the Celtic of the Cayman Islands.
Scholars International look...
Hold on a minute.
...pretty decent.
Mark Campbell is the manager of the Cayman Islands international team. Now, is that Mark... Surely can't be Mark Campbell, the former centre, air and Falkirk centre-half.
Well, there's only one way to find out.
Right, hold on. This is interesting.
I've never heard of him.
No, right, Mark Campbell.
Who did he play with?
He
played for a few Scottish teams.
Did he play for your team, John?
He did, aye.
So, Dwayne Wright is the top goal scorer in the Cayman Islands League of all time. He's actually the same age as me, he's 34 years old. He played with Bowden Town.
Bowden Town?
Yeah. So, the Cayman Islands national football team are now, the head coach is Claudio Garcia.
Oh, is it not Mark Campbell?
It's not Mark Campbell.
He's been sacked.
Oh,
he's
obviously been sacked.
They've brought in Claudio Garcia to tide them over the next wee while. So.
They found out he wasn't qualified enough because he'd played for Falkirk.
Yeah, that's what it is.
I don't think it must be a different Mark Campbell.
Why?
Maybe not. Why is he going to be in the Cayman Islands?
Why not?
That's true.
Could be a tax
exit. Oh, no, I've seen a picture of the Cayman Islands, man. It's definitely not Mark Campbell.
Okay, dokie. Right, let's move on from the Cayman Islands then. I'll leave that with you, producer John, and move on to the football at the weekend. Dunfermline on their winter break at the moment, obviously. I mean, I know we're not in the Premiership, but we're obviously being treated as a big team because we don't play very much anymore. Our game was off on Saturday. Yep, there was a burst water pipe, and we were off sunning ourselves in Dubai.
Anyway. How many players were injured ahead of Saturday's game?
About 14.
14?
So,
there's James McPake with his fire hose.
did you see the pictures? There was a big hole in the pitch.
So who was there through the night with their pickaxe?
Nah, I don't think so. So Dunfermline
listen, just for balance, right? I gave Falkirk a really hard time for not putting the effort in to clear the pitch when there was a wee bit of snow. And down the road, who cleared their pitch and got the game on?
Stenhousemuir,
right?
Yeah.
So I think for balance, I'm going to have a pop at Dunfermline. Where was the volunteers and the fans and the effort to put in to clear that pitch? There was
none. What do you mean clear the pitch? It was waterlogged.
Yeah, but you get the squishy things out.
The squishy things out?
What are those squishy things?
A brush.
No, the rubber bits.
Like a squeegee thing?
Squeegee thing. Get the squeegee things out and get a bucket and pail.
The referee said that it was unplayable. So
yeah, because you hadn't made the effort to clear the pitch.
It was unclearable.
Get, like, sponges.
It was underwater. What you do is you it get, was like well, Atlantis. You
know, by the way, why has never anyone thought of this? See, when you've got a waterlogged pitch, throw, like, 100 sponges on it and then walk around the sponges to soak the water in and then lift the sponges and throw them into a bucket. That would soak up.
Or you could get like water. A massive kitchen roll, like a massive plenty. You know those
bounty.
Huge big,
bounty.
Those big bounties you get, bounties. Loads of them over the pitch. Boom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Boom. So yeah, I think it was pretty poor from Dunfermline not being able to get the volunteers out, to get the staff in early.
I don't think it was
to even make an effort to clear the pitch. You didn't even make the effort.
But there was a big hole in the pitch. What are they meant to do about that?
Fill it in with sand.
Why? And then it would just all collapse.
What, the hole?
Yes.
How big was the hole?
It was a big hole.
Like deep? Was it like...
Yes, it was right through the pitch.
But how deep?
I don't know.
It wasn't that deep where you couldn't not see it. Was it that deep?
It was... If you kept going, you'd get to Australia. That's basically...
Would it get us to the Cayman Islands?
It would get us to the Cayman Islands. To be fair, Dunfermline have had bother with their undersoil heating for years. It must be a total shonky system. So it was a burst pipe, it was pressurised, burst a hole in the pitch.
It was cold as well.
Water pishing everywhere. Yeah, just like that.
Look, listen, and to be serious though, that used to happen a lot. In the noughties, there was when it gets really cold, I remember it happened at Hearts a couple of times. So if you've not...
It's going to be freezing this week as well.
And if you've not upgraded your underground, under soil heating and stuff like that, and pipes, then there's going to be problems this weekend.
Well, Dunfermline meant to be playing Queen's Park on Saturday. I would highly, highly doubt that match is going to be on because it's to be Baltic all week, and obviously now we've got no undersoil heating.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I don't think that match will be on, and that gives us another couple of weeks to get some players back. Anyway, Friday night, one of the worst games I've ever seen in my life. Inverness versus Dundee United. Dundee United will not care. Tony Watt grabbing a last minute winner, and that put them top of the table. All the pressure on Raith Rovers on Saturday, and they crumbled. Only one win in five. Annoyingly, that was against Dunfermline.
That's them done. Season's done.
So Raith Rovers lose on Saturday to Queen's Park, who have now won two in a row. Callum Davidson's first game in charge as well, coming from behind. Lovely goal for their equaliser as well. Really good touch and finish. But Raith Rovers are just, they're struggling a wee bit at the moment. And obviously, they will point to the fact that they've had a great season so far. They've already got more points than they did the whole of last season. So that's an improvement for them. But in terms of the title challenge, would you expect now...
They're falling away now.
Dundee United to kick on.
Yeah, I think they'll kick on and Raith Rovers will fall away. They've had their purple patch. They're going through a bit of a poor time of it just now, and I think that's it for them.
Sam Stanton is out for Raith Rovers, and I think that's a very, very big miss for them.
It was a poor, poor performance and result at the weekend. So yes, Dundee United, you're right, it was an awful game. But Dundee United and their fans don't care. They came down the road with the 3 points. And did you see Tony Watt's celebration? Yeah. He went right up to the defender, who clearly been giving him a needle all game, totally. And just put his face in his face. And I don't know what he said.
But, I doubt we'll ever know what they said, to be honest.
But I do like Tony Watt. And when you've got someone like him in your team who's got that experience, scores goals, good footballing brain in them for that league, they'll do well.
Raith Rovers playing Livingston in the Cup this Saturday. Dundee United got a week off, obviously, because they got put out by Queen of the South in the last round. Elsewhere, Morton won, Partick Thistle won, so it's As You Were, and the other match was a draw as well, Arbroath versus Ayr United. But that did mean the end of Lee Bullen. He has been sacked this morning as Ayr United manager after 2 years in charge. A lot of unhappy Ayr United fans in the lead up to that game, after the game as well. Arbroath on the bones of their arse as well in terms of injuries, and Ayr United could not beat them on Saturday. It means Ayr slipped to ninth into the relegation playoff spot, and Lee Bullen is out a job.
He's, I thought
job
that center. Draw was going to buy him a wee bit more time.
They play Celtic Hearts on Saturday in the Cup.
My reading of that is that it didn't matter what the result was going to be at the weekend. I think they'd already made their decision that he was going to go.
Possibly. Partick Thistle played Ross County, which I'm sure will be triggering for many Partick Thistle fans after what happened in the playoff at the end of last season. And Morton are also in action as well. They're at home to Montrose on Saturday. Right. League One. What's going on here, Producer John? I know you weren't at the game, but Edinburgh City were 50-1. And they were 2-0 up at half-time. What happened there? Falkirk, to give you a wee bit of context, in case you're not paying attention, top of the league, unbeaten, still remain unbeaten because they got it back to 2-2. But you had to rely on what was never a penalty, a dive outside the box that was given as a penalty. Is that not really embarrassing for you, John?
No, it's not. There was six. John McGlynn clearly underestimated Edinburgh. They had brought in five boys in from kind of an on loan from Premiership teams. Didn't know what we
they'd
expect.
Lost nine games in a row before Saturday.
No, but this
John.
Is before they brought in a whole bunch of players during the week there, Stephen. John McGlynn made six changes. He randomly switched the formation to some mad 3-4-1-2 thing, which the team had never played.
Sounds like John McGlynn.
So they were 2-0 down at half time. He made five changes at half time. We could have gone on and won the game after we brought on the big boys. But 2-2, I'll take that. 26 games unbeaten.
If nobody's seen the penalty, by the way,
it's poor.
That Falkirk.
Can we just talk about
ludicrous?
Right, but can we just
release the audio? Release the audio. I want to hear the audio between the referee and the linesman because something's gone. There's something no right about.
Can I just say Michael McKindle, the Edinburgh City manager, had no complaints over the penalty in his post-match interview?
You can't, I mean, I don't want to go.
The only people who have had complaints about this penalty are Hamilton supporters, Stenhouse Muir supporters, and the guy from Dunfermline, who's a Dunfermline supporter, who does the Stenhouse Muir media, who posts it all over his socials and grassed us into the SFA, the big grass that he is.
I know, but I mean, like, blatant cheating like that should be called
John,
out.
John.
Big call. John. Can we just go back to the fact that Cole Donaldson, our centre-half, turned the boy in inside out three times.
John, right. It's not a penalty, right?
It's not a penalty.
I'm going to ask you, is that a penalty?
It's not a penalty.
Right, there you go, it's not a penalty.
It's not a penalty, but 26 unbeaten. It was never a corner for their first. We're not talking about that. It was never a corner.
I will agree that you win some and you lose some, and I do think it balances itself out in the course of a season. So you got away with one there at the weekend.
Yes, agreed.
But I think the bigger story here, 26 games unbeaten, phenomenal. Still the only team in the United Kingdom that is unbeaten.
Yes.
So well done, Falkirk.
Thanks.
Can I ask you one other question?
Yes.
I'm talking about not forget the cups and all that. Just in the league campaign, will you remain unbeaten for the entire league campaign?
No.
You think you will lose at some point?
Yes.
Okay.
I'll look forward to that day.
I know you will, Stephen. You've been waiting a long time, son.
Yeah. Hamilton closed the gap after beating Cove Rangers by 2-0. Cove lost the last couple of matches, not one of the last four, actually. So the gap at the top is 9 points. Hamilton do have a game in hand. Is it 9 points? Have I made that up? It's 9 points.
9 points, a game in hand.
9 points. So if Hamilton win their game in hand, it'll be down to six, and then John McGlynn's wee head will start pulsing and getting a wee bit cracked under the pressure like it usually does. Elsewhere, Montrose lose at home against Stirling Albion. Elsewhere, Queen's South 1, Alloa 1 as well. So it's as you were. Edinburgh City 2, Falkirk 2. And Kelty Hearts drew with Annan at home.
I had Kelty on my coupons because your dad works with Kelty.
Yeah.
Tell him I'm not a happy boy.
Oh, they've done me as well, Stephen. You can have words for me and all.
He wasn't a happy boy on Saturday night. They should have won, apparently. But, you know.
Yeah, that's what I had them on my coupons.
Annan had one shot on goal and they scored with it.
And they scored with it. So there we go. One of those matches.
It was the team that let me down for my coupon at the weekend.
Well, you shouldn't be gambling so much. Right, let's move on to League Two action. And as ever, it's been a busy week in the international political scene and lots happening in the Middle East as well. But he's taken some time out to speak to us. It's President Joe Biden.
Thanks, Ewen and Stephen. I'm thinking about bringing in Gary Naismith as my vice president. What a job he is doing at Stenhouse Muir. On Saturday, it was the Warriors versus the Spartans, and Stenham made history with 11 wins in a row, moving them 14 points clear at the top. Bobby McCall couldn't make it 2 wins in a row as his Clyde side drew with East Fife. The Bride Lovers beat Mighty Elgin City to 2-1. Trenor went 6th with a win over second place Peterhead, who have went to shit recently, and Bond and Reed Rose drew with Dumbarton. Anyway, better get back to dealing with the crisis in the Gulf. See you on the next one, boys.
See you later, Joe. Yeah. There he is. He's getting a wee bit stumbly, isn't
yeah.
he?
Yeah. Gary Naismith, 11 wins in a row with Stenhouse Muir, which is a club record. Well done, wee man. Congratulations. You deserve all the success.
14 points clear at the top.
Yeah, they're going to go up. Well done to you, my friend.
Yes, they are. So Stenhouse Muir heading for League One. Right, let's have some transfer chat, shall we?
Oh.
No VAR in the lower league, so VARWTF is also on its winter break. So let's chat about the transfers. Our very own Jim White, it's Mr. Ewen Cameron.
Yeah.
You've been fielding calls.
Yeah.
All day. What you got for us?
My phone has been red hot, mate.
It's been red hot. Dave Whelan's been phoning.
Yeah, I've got the phone here in front of me, so if there's anything breaking during the podcast,
Harry Redknapp,
I'm going to bring it to you first here on the Big Scottish
wow,
Football Podcast.
Sensational.
Yeah, there's been a bit of business this week. The big
wow.
one was St Mirren getting
Quan. Just say Quan.
Quan from Celtic on loan until the end of the season, subject to clearance, but they should get that clearance.
Sensational.
What about Kilmarnock? Gary Mackay Stephen has penned a deal at Rugby Park until the end of the campaign.
Wow, big move.
So that has already happened. Hearts have brought in a Jamaican international nationalist.
Wow.
Dector Lambikisa is on loan from Wolves. Good player. He's a fullback, subject to SFA approval.
Unbelievable.
What about Dunfermline? Stephen's
wow.
team, to help with their injury crisis and help water the pitch, the Pars have signed defender Walcott on loan from
Fagan
Cardiff
Walcott.
City.
Yeah. He's got Champions League experience with Spurs, I'll have you know.
He played against RB Leipzig, didn't he?
He did, yes.
Yeah, so what about Arbroath? I can tell you what's happening with Arbroath.
Unbelievable what's happening at Arbroath.
Yeah,
they've
completed the loan signing of Ross County midfielder Adam McKinnon until
wow.
the end of the campaign. Irish striker Cal Robinson from League of Ireland Premier
Robinson,
side.
Robinson, what a player.
Drogheda United, they've signed him.
Great.
Inverness have confirmed the departures of David Witherspoon and Killian Sheridan.
Big moves.
David Witherspoon
wow.
will join Dundee United.
Would you
take Sheridan at Dunfermline? He's a
no.
free agent.
No, I wouldn't.
Stirling Albion no. have brought in defender Sam Bird following his departure from Stockport County.
I bet he's flying now, yeah.
Yeah, so those are just some of the deals that have happened in recent days since we last spoke to
what
you.
What about rumour-wise?
Well, according to South African media, Rangers have expressed...
South Africa.
Yes.
It's in the south of Africa, you know.
Rangers have expressed interest in Tashreeq Matthews. The
no
attacker
way.
Is also attracting interest from AZ Alkmaar after an impressive season in the Allsvenskan, which
That's
is a
the
league.
Swedish league.
It is, yes. So, yeah, so that might be happening. Keep an eye on that one.
That's in Sweden.
Yes. Rangers are also pursuing a move to sign 26-year-old FC 20 left-back Gijs Schmal, whose current contract is due to end this summer. So they're looking to maybe get him on a pre-contract agreement.
Boy's got a mortgage.
Joyce Doig, we talked about him last week. He will not be coming to Rangers.
Interesting.
After missing out on Josh Doig, he could be heading to Marseille. Celtic expect to announce the signing of Nicholas Kuhn after negotiating a 2.8 million fee with Rapid Vienna. German winger, 24-year-old. Liverpool goalkeeper, Kaiman. How do you say his first name? Is it Cammon? Caimon? Kelleher. Good keeper. Liverpool's number two.
We'll take any name at this stage.
Yeah, he could be joining Celtic. We've also got Bromby striker Matthias Witzgarten and Estoril defender Thiago Araújo. Could also be coming to Celtic. Araújo, is that Araújo? Yeah.
Yeah.
Motherwell closest signing Adam Montgomery on loan after returning to Celtic from his loan spell. Monte, yeah. Dundee and Aberdeen have both shown an interest in Greg Stewart. Good player, by the way. I was thinking maybe Hearts might be sniffing around
him. He's been in India.
I did make a phone call to a couple of sources of mine at Tynecastle to see if there is any interest in Greg Stewart.
The tea lady, yeah?
No, not the tea lady. Just a wee bit above the tea lady. But no rumours or chat around Hearts wanting Greg Stewart.
The cake lady.
Not the cake lady, but Dundee and Aberdeen are apparently interested in Greg Stewart. Would he be a player you'd be interested in at Dunfermline?
Greg Stewart?
Aye.
Yes.
Yes.
But he won't be coming to Dunfermline. I'd be very surprised.
No, he won't be. Hibs are favourites to sign Adelaide United striker Moussa Touré.
Touré?
Touré on loan. From the Australian side.
A red bus Touré of Edinburgh when he comes as well. Unbelievable. Sensational.
Quite good, that. Yeah. Leeds United defender Chris Moore and Brazilian playmaker Adrian are both on trial with Hibs at the moment. Both have the chance to earn a contract East Road this month, according to head coach Nick Montgomery.
Sensational.
Yeah, they've got some money there, Hibs, so why not?
They've got money. Got money to burn.
Yeah, Dundee are now showing an interest in Jack McMillan at Partick Thistle. He's a good player. I do like Jack McMillan. He'll do well at Dundee if he ends up there, which could see Lee Ashcroft go
Lee
the
Ashcroft.
Other way. So McMillan to Dundee.
Central defender.
Yeah, Ashcroft off to Partick Thistle, possibly. Robert Snodgrass was spotted in Stirling the other day. Maybe he's going to become a Beano.
Quite possibly. Or he might just have been looking at the castle or something. Because it is quite a big castle there. Unbelievable.
Now,
stuff.
If you hear of any juicy gossip, get into us. No, not get into us.
Don't get into us.
No,
that'd be really weird.
No. Get us on our socials. Go to @BigFootballScott.
Get into us. Yeah,
Big Football Scott on Twitter, Big Football Scott. And if there's any breaking news between now and end of the podcast, I'll let you know first.
Okay, lovely stuff from Ewen Cameron and Jim White for joining us there. And it's time for Start Sub Sell.
The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
That's a good one.
So, Start Sub Sell, it was a sort of horror theme because. It's not Halloween, and Ewan was watching horror films. So, the contenders were basically horror villains.
Correct.
So, Jigsaw from Saw.
Yeah.
Freddy Krueger.
Yeah.
From Nightmare on Elm Street. And Michael Myers from Halloween. Nick Gannett says, start Jigsaw as he always wins and always scores. Even when he dies, he wins. Sub Freddy Krueger. As he's good at mind games, he's always in your dreams, nightmares, and sell Michael Myers as he still can't perform in big games and he still can't score with Jamie Lee Curtis, which is a good point. Graham says, start Michael Myers, sub Jigsaw, change your tactics, and sell Freddy as he doesn't help the night before games. And he has to use too much tape wrapping up his fingers, obviously, as well, in case he catches someone. Hello to Ross as well. Start Jigsaw to pick off the weak and feeble and keep the intelligent ones busy. Sub on Myers and sell Kruger. No one needs to be looking at a puss like that. Sean says, start Michael. He'll kill anything just for being in his way. Sub Freddy. Solid conception and execution. And sell Jigsaw. He just wants people to appreciate life. Well, which is a good point, because that's the whole point in those films. Because he takes people who have done wrong in their life.
And here's your chance.
Here's your chance, but you need to do something bad to get another chance, sort of thing. Damien says, start Jigsaw. Even after he dies, his game still went on. Sub Michael Myers is the stamina for when everyone is tired late on. And sell Freddy Krueger, as he only shows up when the game is done and everyone's asleep. Which is a great point.
He only comes in at night when they're sleeping.
Exactly. Yeah. John says, sub Michael Myers, there's a Lammers in there. Transfer Jigsaw. If we don't get a corner, he'll fall to pieces. And start Freddy Krueger. He would pick them apart with those wee fingers. Dave says, sell Michael Myers. Interesting. Prolific, but only available one day a year. which is another good point. Sub Jigsaw for some late twists, and Start Freddy, as it'll make your dreams come true. Mick says, Start Jigsaw, maniacal behaviour with a special talent for punishing people based on their behaviours. Sub Freddy, he's only good for coming off the bench in late kickoffs when others are tired. Sell Michael Myers, because it's the movies are pish.
What? Halloween?
Jason says, Start Michael, he always achieves his targets. Sub Freddy, good to come on and slash that margin if behind and sell Jigsaw to Hearts. He looks a bit like the Mitchell brothers. I don't think he does he?
No.
So based on your votes, we are starting Michael, we are subbing Freddy, and we're binning Jigsaw. So this week's contenders, soap baddies.
Yeah, because last week we were talking about possibly...
Richard
Hillman from Corey is being one of the baddies for Start Sub Sell. And we thought, no, let's not do that. Let's do a soap TV baddies.
Yeah. Right, so...
Richard Hillman's in there.
One of my pals, Owen, who listens to the podcast, got in touch. He gets in touch most weeks about the podcast. He's a Hearts fan as well.
Good lad.
Thinks you're a FUD.
Yeah.
So he has actually given me a list of soap villains.
Oh,
so
brilliant.
I'm happy to use his. If Producer John, you can jump in as well.
Go on.
Richard Hillman, obviously, 100%. As we mentioned. Dirty Den.
Yeah.
Nick Cotton as well.
Nick
Cotton's a good one. I don't know who that one is. Charlie Stubbs.
Who?
Don't know. Do we know Charlie Stubbs?
Emmerdale. Is it Emmerdale?
I don't know. Barry Grant.
Who?
Barry Grant?
Nah.
But he must be one of the...
Janine Butcher.
Butcher has to be on the list.
Chucked Barry off the cliff.
Chucked Barry off the cliff. Showed no remorse whatsoever.
One for the oldies, Ewen. J.R. Ewing.
Well, J.R. Ewing was a baddie, but you want the person who shot him in 1981.
Was it No Sunday Rubbish who
it
shot
was,
him?
It was Fallon. Was it not Fallon that shot him?
Archie Mitchell as well. He was quite bad. Married to Peggy.
Well, did Archie not kill somebody?
Yeah.
Aye.
I think he killed a few folk.
Yeah.
Johnny Allen. I don't know who that is. Johnny Allen.
Yeah.
Right, so...
What about River City? We're missing the Scottish soap here. What about your man in River City? Lenny.
Lenny's a good
Lenny
shout.
Lenny Murdoch.
Lenny's a good shout.
I've not seen River City since my granddad.
Right, okay.
Lenny Murdoch's a great shout. Still going and still terrorising the inhabitants of River City.
Can I also add another Scottish name into the frame here? Trevor from EastEnders.
Oh, Trevor.
Oh, I'm going to get you, Mo.
Trevor from EastEnders.
Then Mo got Trevor with an iron.
Who is the old wifey that was in Take the High Road?
Mrs. Mack.
Mrs. Mack. She wasn't
a killer. Oh, we could do all Scottish then. We could do Trevor, Mrs. Mack, and Lenny Murdoch.
Mrs. Mack was just a busybody that knew everything that was going on.
She was a bad sort.
Again, like, Take the High Road, I just associate with my gran having a tea towel. Like, that's the only thing I associate with Take the High Road.
Right, I like Trevor from EastEnders because he was a badass.
Right, are we putting Trevor in? I think we put Trevor in because that covers off the Scottish angle.
Right.
I think Richard Hillman has to be
Richard's in there. 100%, so it's the third one we need to find.
Janine. It's got to be Janine.
Is Janine a bigger baddie than Nick Cotton or Dirty Den?
I think Janine's brown because she's so cold-hearted. I mean, she didn't give a shit.
But Dirty Den, like...
He was a bad-in in real life as well. Remember that picture with his finger in his mouth?
Yeah, I think there were a few things with Dirty Den. But he's dead now, so we can say that. In real
life... I'm going to say Janine.
I like Janine.
Because even now she's back in the show, she's a badass. She's right. Always been a badass. I think Trevor, Richard, and Janine.
Right, okay. I'm happy to go with that if that's what you want.
Yeah, Trevor, Richard, and Janine. The two biggest soaps in the world. Going with that. I'm happy with that.
Yeah, I'm happy with that.
Right, okay. So what are you going on? Start sub sell. Trevor, Richard, and Janine.
I'm starting Trevor.
Right, okay.
I'm subbing Janine.
I mean, even Phil Mitchell. You can argue. Like, Phil Mitchell's killed a number of people across the
years. Yeah, you're
but
right.
But it's generally for a good reason, though, isn't it?
He's a good baddie.
He's a good baddie. Yeah, he's like Robin Hood.
I don't think anyone has ever described Phil Mitchell as
Robin Hood.
I remember Steve McFadden, who plays him, did a meet and greet at Lorenzo's in Dunfermline.
Amazing.
Oh, Phil Mitchell?
Yeah.
I believe he's popular in the camper van community as well, Steve McFadden.
He does panto, I believe, as well. I actually saw a video of him dancing at a panto. And I think I'm right in saying Phil Mitchell for many, many years, or Steve McFadden, was the only cast member of EastEnders who was allowed to do panto for years because their contracts were so tight.
But he got out of it.
But he was basically like, well, I'll just leave them. And EastEnders were like, no, you can't leave because you're Phil Mitchell. So he was like, well, let me do the pantos then. So it came out this big standoff because obviously all the people for Corey and that do pantos all the time. I think they're a wee bit looser, but the BBC were always funny about it. Whereas Phil, because like, I don't know if people realise there's so much money in panto.
Oh,
yes.
And like, if you're Phil Mitchell, you are coining it in.
Correct.
You're talking hundreds of thousands of pounds.
Yeah. You know, there's a deal in Scotland, River City.
Oh, they only film for 6 months a year, is it?
Because most of the cast are in panto.
Right, okay.
So they stop in
November.
September. I think it's before that because you got rehearsals in November.
Yeah, maybe it is. Yeah.
So, so your Scottish programmes as well, they all stop to give the cast the chance to go and do panto.
Okay.
And then they're back in February to film.
See, that's TV clever,
shows.
Though.
Yeah,
that's clever,
yes.
That's the best for everyone.
Yeah. So I do like Phil, but I think, as John has alluded to, he's like the Terminator. He's not a bad baddie. He's a good baddie, so he can go on the list. Whereas
Terminator's a better comparison than Robin Hood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Trevor was just horrible. Janine was just cold-hearted. Didn't, and I liked Barry. I mean, I was gutted when he got pushed off that.
He's coming to Glasgow soon to do his Barry-Oke show.
He's doing a Barry-Oke show. Yeah. I interviewed him twice. Lovely, lovely guy.
Lovely guy.
Richard Hillman, I think, yes, 100%.
Richard Hillman killed three people.
Yeah.
And, you know, he killed Maxine. He killed his ex-wife, Patricia. I mean, is there a baddie in Neighbours? Paul Robinson?
Paul Robinson.
He's not a baddie, though, is he?
Well, he burned down Lats Hatters, so...
Nah, but there's nobody in it.
There must have been a murder in Neighbours.
It's not a murdery show, Neighbours, though.
That's true.
No.
Like, it's more a sort of happy
show.
What
about Brookside, that guy that they buried under the patio?
Oh, yeah.
Again, if you can't remember it, then there's no point.
Exactly. Right, so, right, okay, sorry, I interrupted you. So you're starting Trevor, because he was horrible.
I'm subbing Janine.
Right.
Just cold-hearted and a winner.
Clinical.
And I'm actually selling Richard Hillman.
Right, okay.
Don't think he's got the stamina.
Right, well, I mean, he drove everyone into the canal. I love you! And all that stuff.
He was
off his rocker. Richard Hillman was
mental.
Did
Richard Hillman get killed by a tram?
No. He drowned.
No. Did you know who got killed by the
Richard
tram?
Richard Kilman?
Was it Norris that got run over by the tram?
No.
Or was it Alf?
Remember they were in Blackpool. Was it Vera? And they were running across and he was trying to kill her and he got knocked over by the tram. I thought that was Richard Hillman.
Richard had managed to escape from the car but drowned.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So a body was later identified by Gail and Audrey and he was cremated. Nice. So he's no coming back.
So he did get killed by the tram. Anyway, that's my three. What are you doing for the three?
I'm going to... This is difficult. This is really difficult. Because it was me who brought up Richard Hillman. And he had... Like, out of the kill list, he's killed three. Janine, to my knowledge, has only killed one person. I don't know.
She's been involved in a lot of dodgy things and just cold hearted.
Yeah. I mean, I think Janine has only killed Barry.
I had a night out with Janine.
Oh, no.
Mm.
Oh, no, that's...
In Glasgow.
Listen to this. So, Janine has killed three people.
Oh, wow.
But he's still behind Johnny Allen, who was in EastEnders, apparently.
Right.
Okay.
Janine's killed three.
Johnny Allen killed seven. Phil's killed five people.
Phil
has killed five people.
Our
Robin Hood.
Nick Cotton has killed four people. And Janine has killed three people.
What three did she kill? I thought she killed Barry's the most famous one. But yeah, so I'm still happy with the three that we've got.
Yeah.
I don't know. Five people's quite a lot of people to kill.
Phil Mitchell's killed
five
people.
Yeah, but the people that he's
killed
the worst. You probably supported him when
Steve,
he killed
them. Go check Lenny Murdoch out of interest, because I think he's done a few people in all. Like.
Oh, okay. He's been there from day dot, isn't he, way River City?
Aye.
Did Stephen Purden's character ever kill anybody?
Nah.
He
ended up just about dying. He's ended up dying a couple of times in River City, isn't he?
I've seen his acting, mate.
Hi, Stephen, if you're listening.
He does as well. I don't know. Great theme tune, I must say, for River City.
Aye, love it.
I don't know, I can't have a There's not a kill list for Lenny Murdoch. No. I can't find. I mean, I can't be asked.
So Janine's a good shout with three.
Yeah. See, I think should we sub in Phil for Janine?
Nah, I'm keeping Janine.
Right. Okay. Well, in that case,
that's my choice, Janine.
I'm starting Richard.
By the way, can I just say, and I hate name dropping here, but when I went out with her in Glasgow a few years ago, she is an absolute joy of a person. Loved her to bits. Janine. Absolutely lovely, lovely lass.
So I'm starting Richard, subbing Janine, and selling Trevor, because I just think Trevor's a bad apple. He'd be bad for the dressing room.
Yes. His attitude, bad attitude.
Really bad attitude. he's a horrible man. And I think he's
can't have that in the dressing room.
He's a rotten apple.
Yeah.
So I'm afraid Trevor's on his way. Let us know your thoughts on our social media channels as well. At Big Football Scott. That is how you tweet us. You can also get us on YouTube as well. Make sure you just search for Clyde on Super Scoreboard and then you'll see us as well. We've got our own wee video playlist as well. If you want to subscribe to that. Remember, subscribe to Clyde on Super Scoreboard. You'll see all the videos dropping. The guys are back, obviously, Monday, Friday and on Saturdays, giving you all the chat from Gordon Duncan and the rest of the team. Your chance to have your say as well on 01419511025. And we are back this coming Saturday with our Scottish Cup special on the Big Saturday Football Show. Myself and Ewen Cameron broadcasting on 4th1 West FM, TFM, MFR on NORTHSOUND 1. We're going to be joined by someone from Bucky Thistle on Saturday.
Yes,
we
are.
From Bucky Thistle on Saturday. And of course, we'll be keeping up to date with everything that's happening in the Cup alongside former Hibs and Aberdeen striker Steve Cowan.
So that's this week's start sub sell. Can I already nominate something for next week?
Yeah.
Classic cartoon characters.
Classic cartoon characters, yeah.
We're talking classic cartoon characters before the year 2000.
Right, that's fine, but save it for next week.
Okay.
Save it for next week, because we've got a very, very important phone call to make, producer John. And we'll find out whether he picks up next.
Jose, 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 Jose.
Okay, former Hearts, Hamilton, cult hero, many other teams as well.
Loved him.
It's Jose Quitongo. He didn't pick up last week. We hope he's okay.
He played for my team in a charity match a few years ago.
I hope he picks up, because we didn't speak to him last week.
I wear my Hearts hat for him every week. He's not going to pick up.
Hello.
Jose Quitongo! Happy New Year, my friend!
How you doing, man?
Not bad, man. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Very good.
Where were you last week?
Oh, last week when you phone, I was running because I left my phone in the car. I was do my exercise.
Right, okay. Where are you, Jose? You sound like you're in the bathroom. Have we caught you in the toilet?
No, I'm in the house.
Right.
In the flat.
You're in the flat.
From the game. Yeah, my breakfast.
So I know we're way past it now, but I take everything. A good Christmas, New Year, all good, all happy?
Everything's cool. Everything's perfect. Can't complain.
And you went to Aberdeen over the Christmas, New Year period. You have a nice time in Aberdeen. Everything okay?
Yeah. Everything's cool. My kids, my daughter, good. Everybody good.
Fantastic.
Excellent. So what are the plans for 2024, Jose?
Well, the plan for 2024... the same last year, you know what I mean? Just take a, you know what I mean? You never know. Sometimes, I will say to my pal, sometimes when you leave your house, always expect to come back home. But sometimes you maybe never come back home. You know what I mean? I just take each day. The same. I just take each day coming. Today is tomorrow, you know?
Yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I mean, you're right in what you're saying. You leave your home, you do expect to come back home, but you're thinking you might not. That's the way that you're looking at life. So just enjoy life while it's here. And before the Christmas break, we were planning to get you into the studio because you were looking to find a girlfriend and we were going to help you do that. Do you have a girlfriend?
Have you managed to pick up a girlfriend recently?
I got three girlfriends now.
Three! Yeah! Excellent. You must be a busy man.
I'm the man now this year.
You're the man. Do you use the blue pill?
No, I tell you, boss, I don't need it. I just the things I eat give me energy.
Right.
And what do you eat to give you energy?
No, see, when I was, the next time I go to the studio, I'm going to tell you the things I go, all my routine.
Okay, you do it. When you come to the studio, you tell us your secrets.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you, boys, I swear to God, see, you try my secret, you go home, the miss is going to say, what the hell, what's the matter? Going to say to his pal, what's the matter, my man?
Okay, right, we'll get you in, my friend.
Can't wait for that. Right, yes. Okay, Jose, enjoy the rest of your day. We'll speak to you next week, okay?
You too, boys. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Cheers, mate.
See you, bye.
Bye. Jose, 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 Jose.
Oh, has he not got a boy that plays football in Scotland?
Yeah, he's got two, is he not? Rico and Jai, I think.
Are they not playing this weekend in the Scottish Cup?
I think
Rico's at Annan, I think now. I'm not too sure where Jai is, but I think Rico's at Annan.
Rico is at Annan. Yeah. And Jai, was he not at Morton?
Aye, he was at Morton.
Yeah, he's at Morton.
Is he still at Morton?
Is he not injured, though?
I think he's had quite a few bad injuries. Yeah, I remember when he was first coming through and he looked tremendous.
Yeah, he was apparently having a really good season at Morton, but I think he might have picked up an injury. Yeah. Do you know what? Because it's Scottish Cup weekend this weekend, should we maybe get Jose in next Monday?
Aye, we could do.
You're desperate to get Jose in.
You just want to know his tips.
I want his tips on how to keep energy up.
I'm off in a couple of weeks' time. Why don't you get Jose in as your co-host?
That would be amazing.
Co-hosting. Try to make that work in my head there.
When are you off?
2 weeks today, so next week, and then I'm off for a week.
All right, John, we'll get him in then.
I meant to ask Jose as well. There's a guy for QPR who's a player called Quitongo. Now, I'm wanting to ask Jose, has he ventured down south at some point to spread the love?
I think there is a
boy for QPR called Quitongo.
I think that Jose ventures down south quite a lot. I mean, just by speaking to him. Right, let's move on to Scottish football's even harder, hardest question. The answer is in this envelope. I have signed and dated it. It is sealed. Nobody is getting in it. And the question is, what is the connection between Scottish football's most expensive player and Dexie's Midnight Runners? So, Ewan, you've had a week to think about this. I'm going to go through some of the suggestions that have come in.
Oh, mate, I don't even know where to begin with this.
So, Darren says, the Clash manager, Bernard Rhodes, signed Dexie's Midnight Runners and sent them to record Burn It Down, which Rhodes renamed Dance Dance. Bernard Rhodes shares a surname with Jordan Rhodes, who is Scotland's most expensive footballer if you accumulate all his combined transfer fees.
Jordan Rhodes has went for quite a bit of money over the years. I don't think he's the most expensive combined.
Lewis says, Dexie's Midnight Runners released a song called Keep It, Part 2, which failed and resulted in five of the members leaving, so it was only Roland and Patterson left, who were referred to as the Celtic Soul Brothers, or the Celtic Soul Brothers. Kieran Tierney played for Celtic before leaving for a record fee.
Right.
Henry says, the hardest question, if Tierney is involved, surely it has to be Subway in Helensburgh. It would tie in with Jambo's own Subway experience. Sean says, depends if it's single transfer fee or cumulative. Cumulatively, I'm sure it's Ollie Burke at 28 million. Currently playing with Birmingham, and Dexies were from Birmingham. Is the answer simple? Is it just Birmingham?
That's good. That's good. Ollie Burke's a great show.
Mark says, in reply to Scotland, and Scotland's even harder football question, ex-Celtic player Kieran Tierney is Scotland's most expensive player at 25 million, and Dexie's Midnight Runner sang about the Celtic Soul Brothers in 1982. P.S. Ewan's happy dance makes me sad. Ollie Burke is the most expensive Scottish player if adding up all transfers, but Tierney is the most expensive transfer. Had to Google, but then realised I couldn't be arsed anymore, so good luck to everyone. So I can tell you, out of all those answers, nobody has it right. All incorrect answers. So,
can I ask a question?
Yep.
Is it an accumulation of transfer fees, or is it Kieran Tierney?
You need to work that out. I'm not going to reveal that information just now.
So I would presume then it's an accumulation of transfer fees. If you're not wanting to answer that.
If you want to presume that, then you can presume that.
Because see, when we talked about Kieran Tierney last week, you didn't say I was right or wrong.
And I'm not saying whether you're right or wrong just now.
I think Ollie Burke's a great shout, whoever that was. There was a couple, weren't there? Yeah, that's a great shout.
So keep your answers coming in at Big Football Scott. It's Scottish football's even harder, hardest question.
Is Ollie Burke's mum called Eileen?
I've got no idea. So nobody has it yet. At Big Football Scott, you can leave your answers on YouTube as well. Always leave your comments there.
Is Ollie Burke's dad Dexy?
I don't know.
That's not the answer then.
Dexy Burke.
Dexy Burke.
I'm not going to give you any clues at this stage. I don't think you need clues. I think you can get it without them.
Is there anyone close from what you've just read out?
No.
Is there anyone on the right lines? That means possibly. They're kind of there, but no there.
I mean, I would be being generous if I said people were on the right lines.
I think Ollie Burke is key.
Right.
That's what I would
say. Well, you can choose to listen to you and Cameron, or you can choose to go another route. It's up to you.
Well, it's between Ollie Burke and Kieran Tierney.
At Big Football Scott, get your answers in there for Scottish football's even harder, hardest question. And now on to everyone's favourite bit of the week. It's time for the penalty shootout quiz. And as ever, for the quiz, we need a quiz master. Come down, producer John.
Hello.
Hello.
How you feeling, Ewen?
I'll just get on with it.
Oh, for goodness. Are you spinning the dummy already?
No, I'm just concentrated.
You're very, very touchy.
It's amazing just how many punters think that I get screwed over week in and week out. So it's not just me saying it and believing it.
Well, somebody suggested a solution and you were like, oh, I kind of bothered.
Anyway,
with that.
Just flip the coin.
15-5. Right.
It's you to call it this week, so on you go.
Tails.
15-5.
Tails never fails.
Right, I'm going first.
Go first today.
Let's get on with it. Come on.
All right, just want to rush it on.
Yeah,
okay,
I'm focused. I don't need any of your. And before you ask the first question, see, when I'm thinking about my answer, can you two not have a conversation about something that's irrelevant because it does my head in?
Right, we won't do that. Well, sure.
You don't have Michael McIntyre chatting away with a guest as somebody's trying to think of an answer. Right. On the wheel, right? It doesn't happen. When you've got University Challenge, you don't have Jeremy Paxman sat there speaking to the cameraman while they're trying to think of an answer.
Cameron, FUD.
Move it. Let's do it.
Do you want to explain the rules and how it works, Stephen?
Yes, so it is five questions, if we even get that stage, because sometimes Ewan doesn't get them. So I win before then. But in theory, it's five questions each, alternate shots, like a penalty shootout. You can get a top bin question at any point at our discretion that is worth 2 points. And if it's tied at the end of the five, we go to a tie break.
Okay.
There we go. Let's go then, Ewan. You're up first.
Thank you.
Right, nice easy one to start. Who grabbed the brace for Falkirk at the weekend? Which player got 2 goals for Falkirk at the weekend? Obviously, a penalty being one of them.
We spoke about it earlier on. Mm-hmm.
And we talked about it on Saturday.
Yeah. Mm. Come on, Ewan. Come on. We need an answer. You're the one who's wanting to rush it here, so... Come on.
Come on.
Come on, Ewan. Come on. Give me an answer. Come on, Ewan. You're the one who's what I got on with. Time for the quiz. Come on, Ewan. Just a wee answer for you.
Callum something.
Callum something.
I'm going to go with Callum.
Just Callum.
That's
like what? Like Prince?
No.
Madonna.
Well, that's Callum. His name.
Right,
somebody said, what's the name of the guy that co-hosts the podcast with Stephen Milne? He just said Ewan. I would accept that.
No, you can't accept that.
Right, I'm going with Callum. Callum Morrison.
Callum Morrison.
Yeah.
Callum Morrison, final answer.
Final answer.
Shot is saved. Yes.
It was a 50-50 ball probably there for you. It was Calvin Miller.
Calvin Miller.
But Callum Morrison plays with you.
Yes, he does. He didn't come off the bench.
Yeah, but that wasn't... It wasn't who plays with Falkirk. that wasn't a question.
Right. Stephen, one for you now. Which one of Hamilton's new signing was sent off on his debut at the weekend?
Oh, I don't know this.
Don't know this.
I don't know this.
You actually don't know it? Get up,
yeah. I genuinely don't know. I don't even know who they've signed.
Somebody who's meant to keep his eye on all right across Scottish football.
You guys were doing the big Saturday football show, and you would have seen all these coming in the video printer and talked about it on air.
The video printer? It's not 1973, John. I can't remember, so I'll say Callum. Callum, final answer.
Callum be yeah. your final answer. Yeah. What a surprise.
Get in.
Damn it.
It's Ben Williamson who they got from Rangers.
Oh, I did see that he signed with them, actually.
Yeah.
Now that you mentioned that.
Right, come on.
Because that was the
right.
tweet for Rangers. The,
shut up.
The Rangers tweet.
Yes, it was. Right. Okay, Ewen. Who won last year's FA Cup? The English FA Cup. Oh, you are kidding me,
Owen. No, wait.
Shut up, John.
The man who said, I want more questions about other
countries,
Owen.
Mate, there's a bigger world than more
there's
football,
a big,
mate.
More than Scottish football, mate.
I was at Hampden last year for the cup final. Who was that again?
Doesn't help.
No, I wasn't. No, I wasn't. I was at Grado's wedding last year. Oh, I'm just trying to remember where I was. The cup fight. Was it Grado's? Yeah. Oh, was it Inverness Celtic in the final? Where was.
Do you want to hear the question again, Ewan?
I know it's English FA Cup. I'm just trying to remember.
Right.
Was it Man City beat Man United? Was it Man City beat Man United? 2-1. Man City final answer.
Man City. Final answer.
Yeah.
Get in! They won the treble.
Right, okay. I just had to just in my own head.
They famously won the treble last
season. I just had to, so I wasn't getting mixed up with something else or another year, just to make sure my own head, right? Was it Inverness Celtic last year?
Yeah.
Right, and one up.
Well, you've kind of given away the answer to the next question I've got written down here there, Ewan.
If it's a Scottish Cup question, I'm not going to be happy.
I'm going to have to change it. I don't feel it's fair
what do you
to
mean?
Write down.
No. Answer the. Give me the question that you've got written down. No, we're not changing fucking questions halfway through the quiz.
Which team did they beat in the final? Man City.
I'll go for Manchester United. That was Ewan's fault.
That was Ewan's fault.
Ewan didn't need to give up that information. That was your fault, Ewan.
Right, okay, question three, go on.
Right, okay, before we go on to... We're happy with that situation that's just happened, yeah?
Yes,
yeah,
Ewan.
Okay.
Ewan, say yes.
Just move on.
Are you saying you're happy with the situation?
I'll let the punters decide.
No, that's not how it works. You gave me the answer.
What a stupid question, because clearly I was going to talk about...
No, you didn't need to.
Why?
Because the question wasn't who finished runner-up in the FA Cup last season.
Right, I'm happy,
okay,
move on.
Okay.
Right, Ewan, which player is Celtic's record signing? Which player is Celtic's record signing?
Is it Dembele?
I think it's Callum.
Is it Dembele from Lyon? Let me just think over the years. Janinho, he was free.
Well, wouldn't it be him then?
No, I'm just thinking of big name players that came. Keane, no, he was alone. Dembele. Did they get him for a free or did they spy him? Oh, God. Oh, Ndombele.
Ndombele
that plays with Spurs.
No, not Ndombele. He was the boy that, and he went to. Not Ndombele. What was his name again? In the midfielder, I liked him when he first came to Celtic.
Malumbu.
No,
that they signed on a free for Kilmarnock.
No, who was the boy that they had in midfield?
You
and he went to Italy.
This is painful. Can you just give us an answer
Dembele.
That isn't Callum? Because I don't think Callum's right. I'm going to give you that.
Dembele,
if it's any
concern. Oh! Edward! It's PSG! Edward, final answer! Get in!
I'm going to raise a challenge here.
No, don't, because that's the answer. Don't be raising any challenge because
what's
it's not
challenge,
a challenger.
My challenge is, how much did Celtic sign Jota for?
By the way, I think you're on the same website as I'm. Odson Edward was 9.5 million.
Right, and how much
Jota
did
Jota was 6.5 is the information that I have.
I'm going to question that.
You've Googled that and you're on Transfer Market. Is that correct?
No.
Right, it doesn't matter. The answer is Edward. You can challenge all you like.
9.5 million for Ross and Edward. By
the
way,
it doesn't matter. The answer's Edward, right? I'm 2-1 up, right? But can I also, right, say something here? He should not be on Google questioning your authority. He's questioning your authority by Googling your questions. That can't be allowed.
One website I did... when I googled it,
it's it came up as
Jota. Let John speak.
The one website that did come up as Jota, and then I went further deep diving into it because I was pretty sure it was Edward, and it was Edward.
Right, it's Edward. That's it. I'm 2-1 up. John, your question. Sorry, Stephen, your question.
Right, Stephen. Here we go. Thomas Stickroth is the record signing of which SPFL Premiership club? It's Thomas Stickroth. Who is that record signing for?
I hadn't even heard of him. He signed for a Premiership club in Scotland.
Yep.
Stickroth.
When? Just recent.
I'm not telling you. You imagine if it was you asking that, and I'd be like, "No, John, shut up."
I haven't heard of him. Stickroth.
I see where you've got Jota from.
It's irrelevant, right? I'm 2-1 up.
I don't think it's Celtic or Rangers.
No, it's not them. It's not Hearts.
I don't think it's Hearts. I don't think it's Aberdeen. I don't think it's Hibs.
No.
I mean, it could be like... I don't think it's Dundee. I don't think it's Kilmarnock. Could be Livingston. Could be Ross County. Could be St Johnstone. Don't think it's St Johnstone. It'll be Livingston or Ross County, and I'll go for... Ross County.
Oh God!
And Marshall has saved.
10.
Yes.
St Mirren.
That's ludicrous.
There you go. £600,000, by the way. According to my facts and figures.
Question 4. I'm 2-1 up. Move on.
Right, this is a bit different. So on Super Scoreboard, you'll be able to see it on the YouTube channel. We did our big winter break quiz this week, and we did a round called Who Am AI, where we got an AI voice to do a famous quote from Scottish football. All you've got to do is tell me who the quote was from. Okay?
Go on.
Nice and easy, right? Okay, so first one up is Simon Cowell. Here we go. This one's for you, Ewan.
I do think there were one or two referees who had a personal thing against me. It wasn't them versus Celtic. It was them against me. I just think they wanted to take me on.
Do you want to hear that again?
Yeah, go on.
I do think there were one or two referees who had a personal thing against me. It wasn't them versus Celtic. It was them against me. I just think they wanted to take me on.
Who am AI?
Do you know who that is?
Simon Cowell.
Yeah, but who is he quoting? Who is he quoting? Who is he quoting?
I think if I was to hazard a guess, I would go for Callum.
I am going to go for... I'm going to go for Gaza.
Gaza?
Yeah.
Final answer.
And Marshall has saved!
Soonest?
You mentioned Celtic.
It wasn't them versus Celtic. It was them against me. It was Gordon Strachan was the answer for that one.
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
oh,
Stephen, now you've got... You're Who Am AI. Here we go. And it is the voice of Darth Vader, James Earl Jones, everyone.
We're slightly different characters.
Sorry, over there. There we go.
We're slightly different characters. He reads and I cannot. We're slightly different characters. He reads and I cannot.
It's actually, I'm saying I canny, but James Earl Jones doesn't do it. I can.
We're slightly different characters. He reads and I canny.
Yeah.
I've got no idea.
It's a famous quote from somebody in Scottish football.
Yep.
Is it Gaza?
Final answer. I wish it was a goal. That would have been beautiful. But it's not. It was actually Scott Brown talking about Stuart Armstrong.
Oh, so it is.
Yeah.
So it is. God, right, yes.
Okay. Another one left over from the old Super Scoreboard winter break quiz was the blankety blank round, okay? I'm going to give you a list. There's a blank on that list. You've just got to fill in the blank.
Okay, understand? Well, I'm 2-1 up.
Yeah.
Going into the fifth question. So I'm happy to go with just the normal question.
Okay. Right, Ewan, your blankety blank round is It's SFWA Footballer of the Year, so that's the Scottish Football Writers Association Footballer of the Year.
Okay.
And the list is as follows: Odson Edward, Stephen Davis, blank, Kyogo. Odson Edward, Stephen Davis, blank, Kyogo.
Callum. McGregor, final answer.
Callum McGregor,
final answer.
Answer.
A Marshall is
no!
Yes!
No!
That's what I would have said as well. I would have said McGregor.
You'll be kicking yourself, Ewan. Craig Gordon.
So it is. So it is.
Stephen!
I would never have said that.
There you go. Your blankety blank is Scottish Championship winners.
If you get this wrong, I'll win the quiz.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ross County.
Mm-hmm.
Blank. Hearts. Kilmarnock. Ross County. Blank. Hearts. Kilmarnock.
I remember the year that Ross County won it. Because I remember they battered Dunfermline about the third game of the season, and I was like, County are going to win the league, and they won it at a canter.
I don't know this actually.
So that must have been 2018, I'm presuming.
Because Hearts got cheated out of it.
Because Hearts got relegated in the COVID year, so that'd have been 20. So, oh no, that must have been 2018-19. So I'm looking for the
year before COVID.
The year before COVID. So yeah, was it not? They did it on like a points, because they relegated Hearts. And was
Who came up?
Who came up? Dundee were involved, but surely it wasn't Dundee were in the Premier League at that point. They were in the Premiership because their vote went into the
email.
They went into the junk folder or whatever it was. Yeah. Yeah. So who came up?
Do you know what, Ewan?
Yeah. Yeah, no, because I was pissed off at that time. Please get this wrong, because I don't want a tie break.
So it's not Partick Thistle.
Who else has been in the Premiership?
I'm getting ready to celebrate. Get my happy music ready, mate. Because I'm doing a happy dance.
If you do win, you enjoy the Champions League or Hearts, Hearts, Glorious Hearts.
Oh, no, with the Champions League music.
Okay. Just to check.
Yeah. Just get me ready for the Champions League music, mate. I'm pulling my chair back right now so I can jump up and do my happy dance. Get the cameras ready on wide shot because he ain't getting this. I'm winning the quiz. This. This is a new beginning. This is me coming back for 2024.
I'll go for Dundee United.
Final answer.
Yeah.
Dundee United.
Yeah.
Fuck! Come on! Yes! Get in there!
It was Dundee United. Well done, Stephen.
Last minute equaliser. There's nothing
right,
better.
We've got an option here. I've got two top bin questions, so I could give you one top bin question each. Or we can just go straight to the... We'll just go straight to the tiebreak.
Let's go straight to the tiebreak.
Yeah. Okay, then.
God.
Right. Here's your tiebreak question. Okay, get your pens and papers at the ready to write down your answers. How many players have had over 70 caps for Scotland? How many players have had over 70 caps for Scotland men's team?
70 plus?
Yeah.
How many players in total for Scotland?
Scotland men's team, yeah.
I've got an answer written down already.
You haven't, have you?
Yeah.
Education
from the very first international
yes
Come on, Ewan, write down your answer.
There's not that... See, they didn't play that many international games. They've played a lot recently, or have done in the last 20-plus years. But in the early days, there were very few international matches. Even qualifiers, you only played like 3 or 4 games. So it would take a lot for them to get to 70. And that's... There's not many that have done that. You think of the record appearance? No, there's not that many.
Write down an answer!
Right,
Jesus,
shut
Christ.
Up! Have you written down an answer?
Yeah.
Seriously?
Yeah.
You're good on tie breaks, remember, Ewan. There's no pressure because you always
I've got
tend
my number.
To win it. Right, okay, he's ready to unveil your numbers. Stephen, what have you got?
Eight.
No. Ewan Cameron, what have you got?
I went 20.
One of you is one out. Is it Stephen Mill? Is it Ewan Cameron?
Oh, God.
The winner of today's shootout quiz on the Big Scottish Football Podcast is Stephen Mill.
Thank you.
It was 7, the answer.
7.
Tom Boyd, Craig Gordon, Paul McStay, Alex McLeish, Darren Fletcher, Jim Leighton, and Kenny Dalglish.
Oh, amazing. Everyone's happy. Everyone's happy. Everyone's having a great time. And Ewan's putting his jacket on and getting his wee bag. That's what happens. So there we are. Great times. Yet another quiz in the bag. What is it? 16-5.
Yeah.
16-5 now, Ewan, in the quiz.
Okay.
Champions League music's just finishing. I know you've not got your headphones on. So there we are, yet another win, and absolutely smashed as per usual.
Wait, there was no smashing there. You were lucky to get Dundee United.
A win's a win, mate. This has been the Big Scottish Football Podcast. A huge thank you to you all for listening and watching on YouTube as well. You can subscribe on Clyde on Superscoreboard on YouTube. And remember, subscribe on podcast as well. I don't know why you put those sunglasses on.
Because it's sunny outside and I'm leaving, that's why.
He's like a shite...
You look like Taxi Driver!
He looks like a shite Top Gun. Bottom Gun. Anyway.
Do you know what? I work with absolute fannies.
We're back next week. You can listen to Clyde on Super Scoreboard during the week. We're back with the big Saturday
it's
football show. And yeah, see you next Monday. It'll be fun. There he goes. Bottom Gun. What a wank.